Hi, everyone. We're thrilled to have people here today to talk about the World Wide Web of Impact. And one of our colleagues who was going to be here from the Ministry of ICT in Kenya unfortunately sends his regrets. So we're so sorry that he was unable to be here. We will try and fill in his absence with Kenyan examples, maybe even. We'll see. So I am Heather Lofthouse. I'm Director of Special Projects at the Blum Center at UC Berkeley. We are the campus's interdisciplinary hub for poverty action and poverty studies. We bridge scholarship, technology, and practice to solve some of the world's most challenging problems. We do that in various ways. We have competitions for students, but we also compete out dollars to teams of researchers who are calling themselves, and we're calling them development engineers, who are working on problems that include internet access globally and in communities, especially rural areas that don't have internet access today or have very little penetration. So I'm personally thrilled to be here, and I want to introduce our panelists. I'll be asking them a few questions. I'll start with Matt Dalio. He is CEO of Endless, which I'm very excited to hear about. It is a personal computer that is affordable and going to be made available to everyone in the world, basically, so a desktop. We're excited to hear about that, and the importance of computer literacy in this day and age cannot be underscored, so I think not only having cell phones, but having computers you will speak to and is going to be really important. Then we have Laura Quintano. She is Senior Director of Corporate Affairs for Cisco. She oversees corporate social responsibility for the corporation. That includes people who she oversees in 40 countries and activities in 170. What she also works on is serving as executive director for something called the Jordan Healthcare Initiative. So some of what I've asked her to talk about today will be some healthcare examples, in particular around internet connectivity through Cisco and what their work is doing. Finally, I'm thrilled to announce Vaughn Hester, who is program manager at internet.org at Facebook. And I think it'll be really interesting to hear from her on this new initiative that so many people are discussing in the popular press and increasingly in academic work. We were just talking about that backstage. So why don't I start with Matt? I have some big, broad questions for you, which is, why is what you're doing important, and why does it matter, first of all, to the world, but then also to Silicon Valley and to people in this room? Why should people in the Bay Area who are doing social enterprise work and social impact work, what do you need to tell them about what you're doing?
Sure, so I'll describe a little bit about what it is that we're doing, and then speak to those two questions. So we are doing something that is rather counterintuitive these days. So the two big trends these days are mobile and cloud, what happens when you get people on the internet. And we are doing the opposite of both of those. We are building desktop computers for people who don't have clouds. And so the question is why? Why desktop and why cloud? If you look at what desktop computers are today, if you look at empirically actually the data on usage, since we started doing this, I think I came up with the idea about 5 years ago, about 10% of the world has gotten access to desktop computers. The number of people who are using, number of hours a day people are using computers each day is actually more today than it was in 2008 when Android was launched. And the reason why, I can sort of look out in the audience and ask all the people who are on their computers, why is it that you still use a computer? And if you look at those reasons, those are actually the same needs in emerging markets, the ability to interact, to create, to do a school research report, right, to do a simple budget as a small business owner. And that today is a need that's not yet met. What we found was that it's actually pretty easy to solve that, and you can solve that really in, if you take the two biggest barriers that are blocking people, the first is cost and the second is connectivity. Cost, the three largest components of cost are one, the processor, two, the operating system, and three, the screen. Well, everyone has a screen, a monitor in their home already. It's called a television. You could take something like a Raspberry Pi and you can basically make a really darn cheap computer, and operating systems don't need to be paid for. You can make them free. And so in the process, you can actually make a computer that is a fraction of the cost of a traditional computer and solve cost. Connectivity, you can solve in sort of a very interesting way where we didn't used to have internet, and computers were still useful for us. We had CDs with Encarta, and we had little floppy disks with 2.5 megabytes of storage, and we would put our applications and our files on there. Now, 32 gigabytes fits on, you know, a little micro SD card on your thumb, and inside of that, you can take the vast majority of Wikipedia content that's actually searched for, and it fits on a gigabyte. And you can take Khan Academy, and it fits on 6 gigabytes. And so you can effectively pre-install a little micro internet onto every device. Now, what does that mean? What that means is that people can then afford the cost of a wireless data plan to be able to do all of the other things that they want to do. So a 500 megabyte data plan in emerging markets is sort of a nice data plan for a smartphone. I can do all the normal things. Facebook is free. The problem is that the average desktop user uses 2 gigabytes of data per day. So what that means is that if you use a regular internet connection on a desktop computer, you've run out of your 500 megabyte plan by lunch. But if you take most of the data-intensive stuff and put it on the device, that means you can do things like Facebook for free, and you can get other, you know, sort of data. I can actually Google something when I, you know, with the precious megabytes I have. So that's what we're doing. That's sort of a little bit of a step back to, for context. Why it matters there and why it matters here. And I'm going to speak more generally just about connectivity, access, information, technology, whether it's through a smartphone, a tablet, a computer. 26 hours ago, I was walking down a little dirt path in Guatemala, and there was two little girls in the place where we had parked our car, and they were in a little house out of cinder blocks and with dirt floors, and one of the girls walks up, 2 years old, and she's got a cold, and she's got, you know, face is all, you know, looks like it had a cold. And her older sister had one shoe on, you know, two different, you know, not matching shoes. Those little girls today are destined to have the same fate for their children that they have right now for them. 36% of the teachers, the math teachers in Guatemala, passed their own math exams. The rest failed. That's for those who are lucky enough to get access to a teacher. Imagine a device in the hands of each of those kids, and packed inside of it is Khan Academy, Code Academy, Wikipedia, the sum of human knowledge, all of this stuff available, whether it's through a smartphone, a tablet, a computer, available. That matters so much more, ironically, than computers matter to us. If I never touched any device again, I'd still have access to an education, I'd still have access to healthcare, I'd still have access to jobs, financial services. To that person, they have none of those things. And to that person, a device means all of those things.
Yeah. So
Just to answer that second question, because it's why does that matter now for here? Because financial opportunity for businesses in Silicon Valley is there. When you provide the power of communication to 450 million people, that's the largest startup acquisition in history, $19 billion. So when you have something that people want, and a lot of them, it's a business opportunity.
Right. So I think that's important, but I do want to press a little more on the connectivity issue. Data show there is an issue around connectivity globally, right? So this is the digital divide that we're all talking about. So in the States, we have about 87% penetration, people using the internet. Most people are using the internet, right? Now, if you look at the spread, many of them are of higher income than those of lower income. So that's one kind of divide. But then if we compare our nation to other nations, there are some countries, especially developed countries, that have few, less than or around 10% penetration. So maybe I can speak to you, Vaughn, and you can tell us a little more about what Facebook and internet.org is doing, A, to bring internet to places where there is an internet, and then to increase penetration where there might already be internet available.
Sure. Thanks for highlighting the digital divide issue. I mean, it's one that was the foundation for the creation of internet.org. Internet.org is a Facebook-led initiative that's working to understand and address barriers to access around the world Our priority countries are the countries with the largest number of unconnected people in them. But of course, the barriers and the context really ranges from country to country and region to region. Our research has shown that the primary barriers to access fall into three categories: infrastructure, affordability, and awareness. And so what Facebook is doing is identifying partners in various markets and figuring out what is the role that Facebook and its partners can play to tackle those barriers in a particular market. So our first offering is what's called Free Basics, which is a set of essential sites and services that can be accessed by anyone at no cost without needing a mobile data subscription or any sort of minimum plan balance. So we think that's a really, really big step forward in terms of improving access to essential services. The second initiative we have is called the Connectivity Labs, which is focused on some longer-term efforts to develop new technologies, scalable network architecture, and just new approaches to rolling out networks and connectivity. And the third initiative, which is the one I'm closest to and the most excited about, is called Connectivity Deployments. And that's a team looking at what are near-term efforts that Facebook can play a part in that will improve access or expand connectivity in the near term.
Yep, that's super. You mentioned the infamous cost word. Mm-hmm. There was one statistic I saw recently that was so interesting to me, which was in India, of people with smartphones, only 57% of those phones are being switched on so the data is enabled. And I think, and you would know more than I would, that that's largely due to a cost issue. I mean, it is cost prohibitive if it's $4 a month to have data. I mean, that's, you know, too expensive for many of the world's people. So what do we do to work on the cost of connectivity? And talk to me about your model is what they call, so it's free, right? It's zero.
So yes, some of our initiatives are free, and I think you've hit on a really important point for people who are working in developing countries, that hypersensitivity to data usage, the cost surrounding data usage is really critical. We're learning a lot about the way that various phones consume data in the background, the way that users might not understand that, and the confusion that might exist. So again, education and awareness about phones and about these data plans is really, really key.
Yeah.
But yes, for the free basics, we are really committed that that has to be no cost and just, you know, have as few barriers to entry as possible.
Yeah, that's terrific. Zero rating is the word
exactly.
I was thinking about.
Exactly.
Which means $0.
Exactly.
So one anecdote I want to mention, too, on that front is we supported a team, we at the Blum Center at UC Berkeley, that is now a social enterprise called Indaga, which sets up village base stations, basically. So erects towers and brings cellular connectivity to rural areas. And they did a deployment in Papua, Indonesia. And one of the anecdotal pieces of feedback, among many that were very interesting, their system has achieved cost recovery, so not quite profitable, but is doing really well. There's a local person there who's running the cellular network. But also, there was much anecdotal evidence from teachers and healthcare workers saying, "We are now that we have access to something like Facebook Zero and are able to connect with our families back home, we are more likely to stay out in this rural area than we would have been. We will stay here longer." And so I think that last mile piece cannot be underscored enough. And as someone who works at a university, I want to emphasize that I think we need more research in this space. We need more rigorous data to tell us what is actually happening when the internet gets to places to where it wasn't, in terms of education, in terms of economic mobility, and those kinds of things. I know we had some great statistics from Professor Jensen, who's now at Wharton, years ago, seminal studies about Kerala in India fishermen, when they got their cell phones, basically the productivity increases. Their income increases, customers benefited as well because they were able to see information and be more transparent about who was getting what fish and what markets actually needed them. And so it just became a more efficient market. So I think a lot of us assume that when we all get the internet, it's all going to be terrific. and people will have more access to information. But I think we need to study more specifically where these changes are going to happen and how we can target interventions based on what we're trying to achieve and what we've learned from previous experiments. Now, Laura, will you talk to us more about how you select activities to work with and how you encourage amplification of impact where you're working? And can you give some health examples in particular?
Sure, happy to do that. And to your point, it's not just about deploying a solution. It's about addressing the area of adoption and then ultimately integration as well, so that you can integrate it into a country's or cities or rural towns' economy, as well as societal impact from a healthcare education perspective. And so let me give you those examples in the healthcare space. But first, I'd start by just sharing at Cisco, in the area of corporate social responsibility, we are leveraging our company's key competencies, our core competencies in terms of our people, our technology, our partnerships to improve the lives of people around the world. And in healthcare in particular, we've taken a multi-pronged approach, and I'll share a couple of examples to bring those approaches to life. One is in working with large strategic initiatives where we're partnering with governments. And the other is where we partner with nonprofit organizations. And so the government example, in particular, the Jordan Healthcare Initiative. I've personally worked in the country of Jordan on the Jordan Healthcare Initiative, partnering with the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of ICT, as well as a number of other key stakeholders, with our shared goal of leveraging technology to improve healthcare delivery and to increase access to quality healthcare services. And we started off small, if you will, to prove out some concepts, especially in terms of connecting individuals in rural communities with doctors, specialists in the capital, Amman. For those of you who are not aware, according to the World Health Organization, over half of the populations in the developing world live in rural areas. However, those populations are served by less than 25% of the total physician workforce. And you can imagine that in least developed countries, it's even more abysmal. And so with that said, in Jordan, the access to specialty care, so think cardiologists, nephrologists, radiologists, if you're in a rural town, access to that specialty care becomes a challenge. I'll tell you a story about a solution that we set up and a patient that benefited from this solution. We set up remote consultations so that these patients in these rural towns could access specialists in Amman using high-definition video as well as advanced audio and third-party integrated medical devices. What we set out to do is to leverage the power of broadband. What that brings to bear in terms of providing a more face-to-face-like experience for patients. And we set up this network, and in terms of a patient example to share, Haifa, who is a woman who is in her mid-30s, married, a mother of five, living in the remote region of Jordan called Al-Mafraq. She had a cardiac condition. And has a cardiac condition, and was referred to a cardiologist by her local physician. However, her condition deteriorated because she missed appointments or wasn't able to afford to get to Amman, the capital, to visit with a cardiologist. And that wasn't a good situation for her, as you can imagine. However, she learned about our healthcare clinic at the local hospital and was able to sign up to see a cardiologist. And in that first visit, he properly diagnosed her and he adjusted her treatment plan. Because that's another challenge, that individuals sometimes will get a treatment plan from a nurse or a general practitioner, but what you really need to see is a cardiologist. You need that cardiologist to also have the tools in order to facilitate a remote consultation. So again, think about high-definition video. You have the advanced audio. A cardiologist has a digital stethoscope that he or she uses in order to properly diagnose a patient. And I could tell you in the words of Haifa herself, she said this changed her life. She now has more energy, more time to spend with her children. And this is, you know, just one example of what we're doing to bridge that divide between an individual's personal circumstances and access to quality care. And I could tell you, we all in all, over the past 4 years, we've implemented four projects in Jordan where we've leveraged technology to provide improved and high-quality healthcare services, and we've now served over 150,000 patients in this partnership with the Ministry of Health and others. So that's the example of working with a government on a larger scale. In terms of our work with nonprofits, I think a good example to share is our work with a nonprofit organization by the name of Living Goods. Living Goods is doing a phenomenal job in terms of reducing child mortality while at the same time creating livelihoods for enterprising women. And we invested and funded a mobile technology platform that they developed to serve their organization. And this platform has enabled over 1,200 community health promoters that are part of Living Goods Network to reach over 1 million people in Uganda and in Kenya. And I could tell you just the power of that, of enabling these healthcare workers to go door to door in their communities to visit with families, to help families, to help mothers learn about how to properly care for their children and how to take preventable actions to improve their health, while at the same time selling life-changing products such as simple treatments for malaria and diarrhea, bed nets, clean cook stoves, water filters, has made a dramatic impact in these communities. And they're taking this platform, this technology platform, mobile technology platform that they developed to lower their costs and improve their efficiency. They're able to manage their inventories, manage their product portfolio, the performance of the community health promoters, as well as offer diagnostic applications that help these individuals properly diagnose patients, while at the same time uploading all of this information to their servers so that they can send out notifications to mothers, for example, and say, you know, don't forget to give your child this medication. Don't forget to complete the treatment plan, because how many of us have, you know, gotten antibiotics or what have you, and then we say, oh, we're feeling better. We don't need to take this anymore. Well, no, you have to complete the treatment plan. And what's really exciting, I think, about the work that they've done is they've been able to reduce child mortality by 25% at a cost of less than $2 per child. That's, you know, that's life-changing. That's impactful.
Living Goods is terrific, and they're always here at SOCAP, and Chuck Slaughter, their CEO, is fantastic. And what they've, to give them credit, they've recently done some randomized control trials to find out these numbers, which is so important. And in the field of social franchising, where there was a lack of RCTs, and that's been increasing with some work out of UCSF and otherwise, I think it's so important. Now, so Living Goods in particular deals with peri-urban and rural villages, right? So maybe you can give me, and then I'm coming back to you, Matt, a couple examples of novel ways that Facebook and internet.org are thinking about or piloting getting connectivity to areas where Living Goods is so that this technology you spoke about can be used.
Definitely. I'm so excited about the myriad use cases that a reliable internet connection will make possible for development actors and governments, et cetera. The team that I'm working with at Facebook is called Express Wi-Fi. I'm really excited because it's a model that will allow local entrepreneurs to purchase an inexpensive set of tools and technology to offer a business selling affordable internet access to his or her local community. It's a really interesting combination of technology and a business model that's geared at sustainability, which we're really proud of. So we're trialing this model in India at the moment. It is a last mile solution. We're working at in 12 sites that are rural, populations of 3 to 20,000. The initial trials are going really well. We have 12 retailers using Express Wi-Fi. Uptake on the part of their community members has been really, really strong. Our goal with these trials is to validate not just the software we're using, but the business model. And by that, we mean our costs of deploying these solutions in conjunction with local partners need to be lower than the revenue that the retailer can make selling these plans. So that's really the question is, can we strike this sustainability? Can we hit a break-even point for the retailer and our ISP partner? If so, we feel really good about scaling this to more countries and hopefully making even bigger impact.
That's terrific. And as so many of us know, many telcos, these big companies, they don't have the financial incentive to go far, far away from an urban area. So we do need these innovative micro-enterprise models. So it's terrific that you're wrapping that around the hardware and software solutions that you were already working on. So super interesting. Now, Matt, I had a couple questions for you. One was, so you mentioned that, you know, all these great things that people are going to have access to on this desktop that you're creating, which I saw, it looks very cool. So there must be some human-centered design that went into it, I'm assuming. But my question is about behavior change. So I, at UC Berkeley and the Blum Center and this development engineering program we oversee, we really encourage students who are developing a novel approach or a novel widget for a developing country to think holistically. We need to think about pricing, we need to think about policy, and we need to think about actual uptake of these new devices or this approach. Again, it could be a government, it could be an NGO, it could be through the market, through the private sector. But so what have you and your company thought about in terms of behavior change and what is going to be required for one of the young people that you mentioned in Guatemala to start actually using that computer? We had one laptop per child and that didn't go well. So now what are you doing that's different and what are you doing that really takes the consumer and a developing country consumer in particular and reveals the demand and integrates that into what you're doing?
I'm so with you. At the heart of your questions, I interpret really as this question of user-centered design and understanding really the reality of how they interact with this thing. And that was at the heart. I think the third person we hired was a user researcher. It was a designer and then a user researcher. And from back in the day when all we had was a little PDF of what the desktop looked like, it was a paper PDF and we're sitting there. We had people using it. It's funny because people fell in love with what we were doing when they couldn't shut the computer down. There wasn't a we hadn't built the shutdown button yet. And at the core, it was just this very iterative process of understanding what didn't work. And there were 1,000 things about our core, you know, first assumptions that didn't work. What it really came down to was design according to something that they already know. And the two paradigms that we use that they already know are first a smartphone. So great, put all the desktops on the, all the icons and all the apps on the desktop. And then the second was Facebook, the two things they know very well. But I'm so with you, it has to start with that. One of the things that we have to our advantage is that people already know they want a computer. It's not a hard thing to convince people of. When I began this thing, really, I did about 6 months of research here and still had no idea if it was a good idea because I hadn't gone and asked people. And so I'd spent 3 months traveling through China, India, Indonesia, Bangladesh, all these places. And that was, it did not matter where you went. It did not matter where on the socioeconomic strata they were. Do you want a computer? If they were under 35, the answer was, you know, they looked at me like I was stupid asking the question. Right? I was like, no. You know, when you'd ask why they don't have one, and you get to the same things of cost, connectivity, and then you're right about their the other things around, if they don't know exactly, you know, where is Wikipedia or Code Academy or these other things, then it's not as useful to them as it could be otherwise. So I love what you're doing with the Facebook Zero stuff because it's two things I love about it. First of all, it's presenting the stuff that they don't know is there that's good for them. And second is it's one thing to try to rebuild the world's infrastructure. That's a long process. But the infrastructure is there, and if you can reutilize it in certain ways by tweaking either the technology or the business model, my God, you can deliver access in incredible ways.
Yeah. No, it's so true. I have one other Facebook-related question. Just thinking about, I mean, even on NPR the other day, there was this neat story in Cuba, and this gentleman who had never used the internet and was now able to do it with his smartphone and was using Facebook Zero to connect with people, or maybe Facebook, to connect with people, and he was in awe. I mean, he was just so excited. But then I read a study where it said 11% of users in the Philippines, when they use Facebook Zero, didn't realize they were on the internet, right? So how do we address the fact that we want to make sure that people understand what the internet is, the vastness of it, the potential of it, and then, and there are different models, right? There's this really interesting company called MSent, which Jhana originated, which basically, you probably know more than I do, but in developing countries, you're able to download an app that's a sponsored app, and once you have downloaded that app, you get double your airtime. And so basically, sponsors are buying airtime for you, and then once you have that app, you don't have to use it, and you can access anything else in the world. So they really consider themselves net neutral. So while that first app is sponsored, then everything thereafter is not. So that's another interesting model that's out there in terms of getting data and this airtime. What else do we do on the education piece? In addition, so now there's internet connectivity. What are some other lessons you all have learned about how to ensure people understand what this means and are taking advantage of every single aspect of it?
Yeah, you're right. That the awareness barrier is really, really broad. It encompasses a lot. We're focused on a lot of the nuances of like the design of our software because first-time internet users or people who aren't as experienced with mobile phones or with basic web browsing will struggle. They'll struggle with account creation. They'll struggle with browser navigation. They'll struggle with understanding Facebook and, you know, how it does or does not use their data, for example. We're trying to calibrate our software and our technical offerings in a way that's really sensitive to that. We're also trying hard to surround all of our deployments, all of our technology with that sort of educational layer, whether it comes in the form of the Express Wi-Fi entrepreneurs that I was telling you about, who are not only probably selling other goods and services to their community in addition to Express Wi-Fi plans, but hopefully being an assistant to new internet users or people who might be holding a device for the first time, really trying to layer that coaching into our training for these retailers so that they understand they're an ambassador and an educator for these communities in addition to a business person. That's one example.
That's super helpful. If
I could add, Heather, so some of what Matt and Vaughn, you've been talking about is, addressing some of that awareness, going into communities where folks don't even understand how to, use these computers. So I could tell you that at Cisco, through one of our CSR corporate social responsibility flagship programs, the Cisco Networking Academy, we are addressing areas like digital literacy. How do we drive digital inclusion, especially for marginalized communities? And I'm proud to say one of our courses actually originated out of Brazil. And it was developed initially in Brazilian Portuguese that we are now tailoring for the rest of the world. And it's because in working with local communities in Brazil, getting access to technology for individuals living in favelas, for example, whether they're older individuals or even younger. How do you educate individuals so that they can be part of everything digital that's going on? Not to mention, through the Networking Academy, we also provide e-learning curriculum, simulation software, access to a learning platform, so that students around the world, we reach 1 million students a year through academic partnerships, community partnerships with over 9,500 institutions, so that individuals can acquire skills, whether it's skills around basic PC hardware software repair, to skills associated with networking and how to set up a network, troubleshoot a network, maintain a network. Those things are all very, very critical to driving adoption. You have to address the area of human capacity building, I believe.
Yeah, Yeah, no, without a doubt. And to follow up on that, what criteria do you consider are important or do you look at when you're thinking of making investments and finding projects to work with?
Sure. So the two examples that I started out with, so when it comes to a very large strategic initiative such as the Jordan Healthcare Initiative, right. We're looking to work with governments who have a shared vision, mission, goals. Okay. If we can't align at the very top along those lines, it's going to be hard for us to get certain things done. So that becomes very important, not to mention that we do quite a bit of due diligence to ensure that we're going to have measurable impact. And that impact has the potential to be replicable and that it has the potential to be sustainable. And I say potential because you start out with pilots. You start small, but you think really big in terms of what the opportunity could be. So that's as it relates to large strategic initiatives. When it comes to nonprofits, the example I gave with Living Goods and we funded a mobile technology platform, we're coming at it from a perspective of applying what venture capitalists do when they invest. So we apply a venture capitalist type approach to investing in social innovation. And so we're going to come in early stage. We're looking for technology-based solutions. We're looking for solutions that have that potential to be replicable. And we also want to ensure that the work that's being done is targeted towards the underserved. And it's interesting because it's a space where we find that some of the nonprofits that work with us say that there's not a lot of funding out there sometimes, or like seed funding for early stage and for things that are technology based. But I think we all share a shared view that technology has the power to really extend one's reach to communities that are the most vulnerable and underserved. And so by providing the seed funding, we allow these nonprofits to prove out their models, to prove out concepts, which they can then leverage to go and raise money from other funders.
Yeah, if I could say something on that, you're hitting on something that I think is so important, which is the largest startup acquisition in history was because of emerging markets, 450 million emerging market users. Kenya, as you said, we talk about something happening in Kenya. 33% of Kenya's GDP runs through M-Pesa. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
If you go to Kenya and Nigeria, there's something called Cheki.com. It's basically cars.com. It sells cars that cost between $5,000 and $50,000. It has a billion page views a month. These are financial opportunities. If you look at Bain and McKinsey both did two studies and said, what's the next trend of the next, what are the next largest trends of the next decade? Far and away, about three times the size of the next largest trend, larger than the baby boomers and all of this, was the next billion consumers. And this is the thing that I think Silicon Valley needs to really understand, is that it's not just philanthropic opportunity. It is where Uber started because people needed a black limo on demand at 2 in the morning. Now what is it, $50 billion. We have such small needs here. It's so hard to fill our needs. There are so many needs there that people have money and are willing to pay. Guatemala is a country that more than half the population is under the poverty line and spends 25% of their income on education. If you can deliver a better educational solution than the alternative, which is not very hard, my God, that's an opportunity as a business. And this is the thing I think that should be talked about a little bit more in Silicon Valley, the opportunity that is there.
Yeah, I think so too, and especially at SOCAP, because that is
this is it.
But we also have to remember that a lot of these business models, we cannot forget the poorest of the poor, right? So as long as we're not bringing mobile money to middle income and higher income people, I mean, we need to make sure that that bottom of the pyramid is really not just talked about, but actually gotten to access and improved. So the mobile money example, I mean, it's so tough. So yes, M-Pesa is doing phenomenally well, but a lot of these financial models around mobile money, there's not a lot of uptake yet, right? And the poorest of the poor, if they do use financial transactions in this mobile way, they're small amounts and they're taken out immediately. And there's no savings aspect to it, right? So I think all of the things you said are so important, and the promise is there and the markets are there, but we have to be able to tweak the enterprises so that whether it's cross subsidies or whether it's just the way we launch things or whether it's the way we market, we need to include that bottom cadre of consumer on that economic pyramid, and we have to be so careful about that. And I think that's what so many people here at SOCAP are interested in doing.
I think you're so right. There needs to be solutions for the base of the pyramid. The interesting thing is, so 40 years ago when the term was coined, base of pyramid, the world's income distribution looked like this in such a way that you could call it a pyramid. Today, 1 billion people have been brought out of poverty, and so actually the world is a very normal distribution. Most people are in the middle. And if you look at the needs they have there, so they have spending power, right? The richest man in the world, I guess he was just beat again by Bill Gates, but was Carlos Slim. Why? Because he delivered technology to the middle of the so-called pyramid, the middle of the bell curve. And one of the things that I think is a very unfortunate misconception, if I could be, is that people think the money's up here and the need is down here. And they forget that most of the world is here with both money and need. And that the solutions that you make here are very different than the solutions you make here. And so much easier. Oh my God, I could tell you people, you know, we sit down with 16 teachers and we show our computer and 14 computers are sold on the spot. They need financing. Mm-hmm. But this is a solution. And this is a more expensive computer than the stuff that's possible. That's not possible at the base of the pyramid, and so what that means is that the solutions become a lot less scalable.
Right.
So it's actually, you're hitting on exactly one of my most passionate topics, which is most people are in the middle, and that is the opportunity, I believe, to change the world at scale that was never before possible.
Right. I mean, I think the graft continues to shift, right? So we will see where, if the, you know, the bulk is in the middle in, say, 10, 20, 30, 40 years. But that gap still exists, right, between there is inequality and growing inequality in many countries. So, but there are successful models of bottom of the pyramid, like living goods, for example, their average products are very inexpensive, and while they're many of them have a co-benefit of, you know, it's something pleasurable, but it's also something that will benefit people, like toothpaste, you know, so things like that. So I do think they're models. Now, selfishly, because I work for a university, I'm curious. The topic of this panel is impact. So how would you determine that impact has happened in the way you wanted it to when you set out on your project, whether it's Express Wi-Fi or whether it's one of, you know, your academy or something else, maybe it's your healthcare initiative in Jordan, and your business. If you were to have a dream team of professors right here and researchers, and you were thinking about impact, I'm curious, what are the questions that you would like to have answered, including not just, you know, I've sold however many computers, but what are the secondary effects you'd be looking to see that would mean that you have achieved impact and done things you wanted to do with that, you know, double, triple, bottom line mindset? Do you want to start, Matt?
I think there's two answers. One is the statistical data. So I would want to see, obviously, educational improvements in terms of outcomes. When you see a story of a kid who's learned English, taught himself English because of a device, and is now teaching himself programming because of a device that's in his hands, and you sit down and you really understand that person's life and what that means for little, you know, 12-year-old Jimmy, it's not quantifiable. You can go and you can quantify the elements that make up their life, so I would want to understand where was his English scores before, where his English scores after. That's really easy to measure. He speaks to you conversationally. But the thing I think it's so important in this is to remember that these are stories and lives, and that if you meet the people and understand the nature of what their lives look like, you know, like the Facebook has these incredible, beautiful videos of people who have been connected and that, what that difference makes, and you can quantify that, but if you try to quantify those as a whole, you actually lose the power of those stories. And so I would say that it's important to do both. It's important to do both. We need to do a lot more of the former.
And I would agree with that, because I thought you were going to go down the path that it's just about the stories. The stories are compelling. Don't get me wrong. I think that what helps others relate. The impact has to be there, because otherwise, it's like anything else. You need to look at the return on the investment. It's not just, I could tell you at Cisco for us, it's not just about cutting a check. Right? You know, if it's about cutting a check, you just cut a check, you know, and you're done with it. But it's really about, did the investment we make result in an outcome, the desired outcome? So I could tell you, and I'll start with the Cisco Networking Academy, an area I'm very passionate about. We measure impact in so many different ways, from surveying students online relative to the quality of their instructor, to the quality of the curriculum, to outcomes. How many of them got a new job as a result of participating in our program? How many got a better job? Acquired skills such that they now got a promotion or expanded responsibilities or increased salary. How many, through participating in our program, went on to pursue ongoing educational opportunities? And I can tell you, I'm proud to say that the numbers are pretty compelling. 52% of students that participate in our Cisco Certified Networking Associate curriculum, 52% attribute their participation to getting a new job. 72, and these are global figures, 72% attribute their participation to a better job opportunity, and upwards of 92% plus, and by the way, these are cumulative, so 52 to 72 to 92% plus say that participating in the program either got them a new job, a new opportunity, or an educational opportunity. And that's just with the Networking Academy program. We've dove in even deeper, and we've looked at the body of students that have taken our Cisco Certified Network Associate courses, and from 2005 to 2013, I can tell you that 1.2 million new jobs were attributed to participation in our program. So that's the kind of impact we want to have. With regard to other initiatives, and again, I'll go back to the Jordan healthcare initiative, we in fact will pay for research to be done. I provided a grant to the Jordan University of Science and Technology. You probably, I don't know if many of you have heard of it. It would be the Harvard of Jordan. And they conducted research on the projects that we put in place in Jordan in the areas of telemedicine for cardiology, telemedicine for dermatology, and telemedicine for nephrology. And they were able to report back in terms of comparing the solution we put in place to what patients might experience otherwise, and we're able to demonstrate that, yes, there were improvements in a patient's treatment plan. Yes, that this benefited the Ministry of Health in terms of their own cost savings, but it also benefited the patients in terms of addressing affordability. And I could tell you, in investments that we make in nonprofits, whether it be Living Goods or others, when I say we apply a venture capital approach, I mean it. We have a team, our public benefit investment team. They are setting metrics from the get-go, and they are working with these nonprofits to say, where are we at checkpoints? You know, where are we along the way? Because at the end of the day, it is about being able to measure those outcomes.
Yep. Terrific.
I would echo what's been said. I would say for us, the two kind of key research questions in the long term are, is Express Wi-Fi and the broader set of internet.org initiatives truly creating recurring internet users? So, you know, regardless of what technology or offering a person has connected with or tried, do they convert into a regular, hopefully paid internet user through some of the channels available to them? That's really hard to measure.
Yeah.
So again, I would say if there are partners or academics who are really interested in that, it's certainly worth discussing further. The second question for us is just the economic and financial one. Do the costs of these deployments and the costs for our ISP partners, can we recoup them through the sale of these paid plans? We're optimistic that we can, but again, we're looking at a very small geographical area right now for some of our trials. So what does break even look like kind of globally, and
right.
What's a timeline to break even that is going to be appealing for individual retailers mm-hmm. who buy into this program, and then for ISPs who are providing these networks, in some cases building new networks? That's a bigger question, and so I do think from a finance and economic perspective, some deeper analysis and optimization is really going to be key to us scaling this.
Yeah, and then I think phase 2.0 would then be, okay, now we have these repeat users, mm-hmm. right? What has that meant for their, you know, job situation? Yeah. What has that meant for the amount their kids are studying? What is it, you know, or staying in school? So I think those secondary effects are going to be so important once we have that baseline data. So we have about 8 minutes left. I wanted to know if anyone in the audience had any questions. I think I was allowed to ask that. I see two hands, and I don't know, three hands. This is like an auction, four hands. And you have two hands? And I don't see a mic, so can you please shout? And tell us who you are and where you're from, because that's interesting.
I know, I'm getting over this cough, too.
Thank you.
You touched on content a little bit in your talk, but not a ton. And I think there's connecting, and then there's getting people content that matters. And so I'd just love to hear some comments about how you source content, you know, how do you make sure it's both culturally and, you know, locally sensitive, and then at the end of the day, useful.
That's great. So,
address that. And I'll come at it from the perspective of our Cisco Networking Academy program. I mentioned earlier that we provide the academic institutions that we work with e-learning curriculum. We, in fact, source the content a couple of ways. Primarily, we work on developing the content. So, for example, I mentioned our Cisco networking courses. Networking is a core competency of the company, and so we will develop that content. In some cases, we will work with partners to develop content as well. And you're right that content is critical, but not only the content, but also the various modalities you would consider in terms of how an individual learns. So it's very important for us to incorporate in hands-on activities, so labs, because you know that many kids learn by doing. We have simulation software because some young people learn better that way as well. And a big part of our content, if you will, is also assessment, both summative, formative assessments with personalized feedback. It's been a feature that we hear time and again very positive feedback on. I could tell you I have three kids, and I've yet to ever hear my children come to me and say, "Mom, I love exams." But I could tell you, having visited our Cisco Networking Academies around the world, when I ask students, you know, what is it, you know, that you like about the program, I will get students say, "Well, I love your assessments." And I'm like, "Okay, tell me more." And it's the personalized feedback. They say time and again, when a student is in a class, typically you experience that you know you got something wrong, but you don't know why. Whereas if you can use technology to let an individual know, this is what you got wrong, and oh, by the way, here's where you can go to figure out how to get it right, you know, that's powerful. Yeah. And so happy to talk to you more about this particular area. We also have invested in Mind Research Institute. That is, that's a nonprofit that teaches math skills to elementary school students. And they are taking a similar approach of what you explained. No language. It's using Gigi the penguin to help students learn math.
And you said it was CodeSpark?
Okay. CodeSpark, okay.
Yes, you have the mic.
Yes, I do have the mic. My name is Amy, and I work for a company called MSurvey. It's actually based in Kenya, and we conduct surveys through SMS text messaging. So there's two arms. One is market research, so surveys are sent out. For example, Java House, which is like the Starbucks of Kenya, will send out a survey after someone makes a transaction saying, how was your coffee, did you enjoy it? And then they can reply. It's two-way messaging, so they can reply and say, yes, good coffee. I work for health and academic research, so they're following patients. Maybe after a woman goes to an antenatal care visit, they follow up with whether she gave birth, where she gave birth. Anyway, my question is, we are starting to sort of dabble in this idea of impact measurement because I think lots of people are looking for that. And the idea being organizations would be able to send surveys to their actual people who they're serving and say, how did you receive this service? I was actually kind of thinking, think, Vaughn, you were saying about, you know, asking about people connecting, so you could access them through SMS text messaging. Most people do have access to a simple phone. But I'm kind of wondering if you know of any other strategies about impact measurement where you're actually sourcing the information from the public, I guess, instead of these secondary sources where you're getting information to measure.
I would just say that we're seeing a tremendous need slash opportunity to incorporate partners like yourself, third-party agencies or companies who have either a simple or scalable technology for that feedback or that survey mechanism into these deployments, because we don't have the reach or the coverage to be doing high-touch qualitative or quantitative follow-up among all of our users. So in all of our markets where we're either deployed or considering deploying, we are looking for third-party marketing agencies, research agencies who can help us get that feedback in real time, both from our retailer network and the broader set of users. So,
and I'd have to plug Open Data Kit out of the University of Washington, which is a terrific tool that other people are, people all over the world, whether it's small NGOs, USAID, are now using. You must know about it. So I feel like they have many use cases, and it's amazing to see how many people are using Open Data Kit right now. So that might be informative in one way or another to visit their latest and greatest update. Who has the mic? Yes.
Hi, my name's Catherine Cheney, and I cover the West Coast Global Development Community for DevEx. So we write for an audience of global development professionals, and when it comes to innovations for connectivity, a lot of that's coming from the private sector. And I'm just wondering how you think the international development foreign aid community can kind of keep up with and support some of these solutions. So I think about the Alliance for Affordable Internet, for example, kind of a coalition. How do you think that the global development community can link up with you all so that there's more momentum?
Right. I'll speak to that really quickly. So I think the global development community is keeping up. So the project I talked about, Endaga, that is bringing rural connectivity in multiple places across the globe now, again, that flagship example was Indonesia, that was funded via USAID through UC Berkeley, and then we were the ones who were sourcing, right, and trying to find promising technologies. But they continue to flag for us that ICT is an area, ICT for accountability, mm-hmm. ICT for the sake of ICT, ICT in terms of elections, ICT. I mean, it really is, I would say, a priority for USAID, who I work closely with, so I know that. In terms of other aspects of how the development community can keep up.
I'll just say, in some cases for us, it'll come down to an overlap in the coverage area between our team, a local ISP, and maybe some other local partners. So I would just say making those introductions and connections early, kind of at the country or market level, such that if an opportunity arises for collaboration in a particular site, people are already connected and informed about their respective offerings. That can be really, really good.
Do we have one more question? Yes, please.
Or actually...
Brad Kane, formerly head of an e-learning organization. I have a quick question for the panel. Of course, it's the answer that's not quick. It's about the conundrum about the device. Yes, often devices are cell phones, which are, as we all know, predominant in many parts of the world, are ideal for checking crop prices or different things like that or alerts. But what happens with e-learning when typically there's a good e-learning platform is very robust. For example, how can you teach CAD/CAM on a cell phone or a smartphone? Your thoughts on that?
Well, I think Matt might be the one to answer that question. Call me crazy.
That's why we're doing what we're doing. I mean, that's the crux of it. I think smartphones are incredible for a lot of things, really incredible things. And computers are also incredible for really incredible things. And they each are good at different things. I mean, it's sort of, I don't know, at this point, it's the essence of why we do what we do. That's is right. Precisely because of that, that you can't do the things that you were describing along with about a million other things through a device that's, you know, 3 or 4 inches in screen size. So I'm totally with you.
And there are interesting things happening with different mobile devices, tablets and micro pico projectors, and we run several competitions where we're trying to encourage new uses around existing technologies. for the sake of literacy, financial, and you know, phonetic literacy as well. And we, yes, last question, and I'll find you afterwards, I promise, yes. Or you can come up.
But it's working now, sorry. I am Franck Langevin from France. I just have the question about languages, because when I see here like so many interesting projects that are based in India, in Kenya, where obviously now English is, you know, the main language, so it just, you know, ease you know, the deployment of this project. But how do you deal with the number of languages in Africa that is not neither English or French? And I would love if French were like widespread, but it's not the case. So how do you deal with that? You know, talking about content, I mean, yeah, this content doesn't exist in those languages. Maybe like, you know, the game without any, you know, with only picture would help, I guess, but you know, that's kind of an issue, I find. So I don't know how we deal with that. It's just like a very open question, sorry.
I could tell you, with the work we do around the world, you hit on an important point, translation. And in some cases, it's not even just translation. I think to one of the questions earlier, it's also localization, right? What's appropriate to use within certain cultures. We have our courses translated, last I checked, at least 16 different languages. I could tell you we've made a strategic decision to translate most of our most popular curriculum into the 6 UN languages, which includes English. And that's because if you, with the 6 UN languages, you will reach 60% or more of the world's population. With that said, we have processes in place to enable our partners, our local partners, to translate using translation tools. So you're right. I will tell you, the further down you go in the education system, the more translation becomes important. Once you're at the university level, it's we still have countries where, you know, I can tell you French is one, you know, French, Spanish, etc., are still really critical. But English becomes easier for adoption purposes.
Terrific. I think that's all the time we have, but yeah, there is one more question, so I grant you access to come up on stage. But let's have a round of applause for our panelists, and a thank you to you all for coming.
Thank you.